To present the award to Vicki, please welcome back to the stage President of the Anita Borg Institute, Telle Whitney, and our honoree, Vicki Hanson.
Hi. Like Maya, I find that a hard act to follow. You know, I wish I could just sort of say, sit down. Thank you, and I'm sit down. That was really impressive. Anyway, but I will say a little bit more. So first, I really want to thank the Anita Borg Institute for this amazing honor. I'm really touched by the whole thing. And in particular, I'd like to thank my nominator, Irene Greif, and the committee for this award. I know there were so many deserving candidates, and I really am honored. Receiving this award for social impact, though, does give me an opportunity to talk about some issues that maybe some of you haven't thought about a lot. So from the video, you realize that this award was related to technology for people with disabilities and for older adults. And for many of you, this may have sounded like a bit of a niche area. Actually, about 1 in 5 people have a disability, and I think that all of us hope to be older adults at some point in time, given the alternative, right? Okay. As I mentioned in the video, people aren't necessarily disabled by a hearing loss or by low vision or by some motor impairment. What they're disabled by, really, in our context of technology tonight, is the fact that there is a mismatch between the technology and their skills, meaning that the technology is not appropriately designed to meet their needs. So consider, for example, the internet, which was talked about in the video. Most of us find it hard to get through the day without going through, you know, our email and browsing the web to find out all kinds of facts every day. But if you have a vision loss, how do you read the pages on the web, right? If you have difficulties with your hands, how do you navigate the web? And if you have a hearing loss, how are you going to be able to understand this acceptance speech when it gets up on YouTube? Okay. It's through the efforts of people who do work on inclusive technologies that there are ways to help. So text-to-speech makes the web understandable by people who have trouble seeing. There's various ways to navigate without using a mouse or a keyboard or even a touch input. And through captioning or sign language, you can make the audio portion of multimedia understandable. None of these solutions are perfect or they're easy, though, for those who have to rely on them. And while I'm talking here tonight about accessibility, one of the interesting things is one of these amazing life coincidences. I wanted to point out that today is Global Accessibility Awareness Day. So while I'm here tonight talking about accessibility, there have been events going on worldwide to help try and raise awareness of accessibility today. Some of the events happened here in the Bay Area today. I don't know if any of you were involved in them or heard about them. What I'd like to do is challenge each of you who develop software to think of software and devices about the diversity of people who will use them, or people who may not use them if these things aren't appropriately designed. And if you're building tools for people who are going to be in the workplace, make sure that you develop tools so that no one is left out of the workplace because of the technology that you develop. We know, and it's been mentioned here earlier tonight, that technology that's tested by a diverse group of users tends to be more usable than technology that is just tested by the small range of 20-year-old early adopting, usually males, right? So if you're developing some new technology, think about testing it with a wider range of people. Bring in some older adults to try out what you're doing. Bring in some people with disabilities to do the testing. So in addition to encouraging you to talk and think a little bit more about technology for diverse users, I'd also like to say just a little bit about careers for women professionals in technology. And in many cases, though, these issues for women in technology really aren't issues for women alone to consider. We really have to think of this much more as a societal issue. So I'm glad to see that there are men in the audience, because many of these issues are really issues for men and women to work together to solve. However, there are some unique issues for women in technology. And my husband, from the video, always likes to tell the story of 2 days after I had a C-section for the birth of our first daughter, I was apparently climbing up the stairs of our house to get to the computer to finish writing a grant proposal. The proposal was successful, which is the good news, and I did take maternity leave after that. So I don't really recommend this as something to do, you know, to be working on a grant proposal right after the baby's born. And I also have to say that I don't remember the crawling incident at all. I think this is one of nature's ways of, you know, preserving your sanity somehow. But that kind of having to do the crawling up the stairs 2 days after a C-section is one of the kinds of unique challenges that I think women professionals do face. In terms of my own background, I came from an inner city, non-academic background, and I know that my wanting to go to college was something that my parents considered really odd, nevertheless supported me. Although I know that my mother really, really always harbored the hope that someday I would come to my senses and become a hairdresser. Not gonna happen, right? But apparently I wasn't the only one in the audience who had that vision for a future, right? Very common, right? Okay. Throughout my career, though, I have been blessed by people who have believed in me. No one ever told me that I couldn't or I shouldn't follow the path that I wanted to follow. I wanted to just mention a couple people and thank them very much. My graduate advisor, Michael Posner, a National Medal of Science awardee, he was always there from the beginning to support and guide me, and to this day remains a good friend and supporter. Get in there and you know, do what you want to do. On the video, you did hear about Ursula Belugi. And then later, when I went to IBM Research, I had the pleasure of working with Fran Allen. And some of you in this audience, I'm sure, know Fran. She was the first ACM Turing Award, first female ACM Turing Award winner, and a huge supporter of getting more women into the computing profession. And as the last thing, I'd like to say that I find it really awkward to be standing up here tonight with all this attention focused on me, because nothing that I have done has really been done alone. It's all been done in teams. I'm sure everybody else who's going to be up here would say the same thing. So for everyone, it's really so important to build the collaborations, to build the peer network, to build a mentor network, and to get involved in being mentors to other people. This is true at all stages of your career. And as many of the ABI winners have said in the past, it's also critical to find people who are important in your personal life to help you. We all do have to make choices in our life, and I'd just like to say that the best choice that I ever made in my life was a choice of my partner, my husband of 30-some years, John Richards, you mentioned in the video. So he's always been there to support, and believe me, he's had to put up with me for all these years, and he's had to go the extra mile, literally, traveling around many times with me, like coming here tonight, and moving to Scotland to support my academic career. So I really wouldn't be here tonight without him. And finally, I can't get off the stage without mentioning our two daughters. You did get to see them in their younger years in the photo here. The younger one now, though, is getting a degree in music, and the older one is finishing her PhD in human-computer interaction. Yes. These two girls had to endure endless hours of incredibly boring dinner conversation growing up. John and I tended to talk about work endlessly. We were collaborators on many things. Despite this, the girls don't seem to be too scarred. They've grown into being wonderful people. And one of them texted me yesterday as I was getting on the plane to come here, and her text just simply said, "I'm proud of you." I know. So I'm proud of them too. And I'm very pleased to have received this honor. Thank you. Thank you very much.